This show is brought to you by Headspace. Go to headspace.com/joey and download the free Headspace app right now. Begin their Take 10 program for 10 days of guided meditation at headspace.com/joey. Show is also brought to you by onnit.com. Go to onnit.com and use code word church to get 10% off all of their great optimization products like Alpha Brain and New Mood.
What's happening, you bad motherfuckers? Uncle Joey here. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to the church of what's happening now. My main man and little brother, Mr. Lee Syatt, here with me. It's been a while since we've been on. The last time we were on
Tuesday,
we were on with that fucking lunatic Mike Dowd. I want to thank him for coming on the show. He came all the way out from New York, and we had a great time. He was a good guy. I haven't seen you. You got sick and shit all weekend. I didn't feel too fucking good.
Do you get the flu shot? I never get it, and now
no,
I think
I
I'm going to.
No, I ain't getting that shit shot to me. It's bad enough we got to bump into it 18 fucking times. You just got to wash your hands. You got to wash. You know, when you go to a big fucking 24-hour fitness, the flu lives in those places.
They do, and I've been spraying it ever since I had that fucking fucked up eye happen. I've been spraying everything.
You got to go with. It's so weird, the shit that's out there now, when you have to. But they say that putting that antibacterial on your hand is also bad for you because it breaks down your hand's own ability of breaking down germs.
Right, so it breaks down your immune system. But the thing that blew my mind as I got older, when I grew up, my parents always stressed covering your nose, covering your mouth. I see people now just sneezing into the air.
They're fucking animals. We got no class. We got no nothing. They're fucking animals. I see people sneezing into their hand and opening up a door. The thing that gets me sick is when I smoke pot with people. That's what always gets me fucked up.
Especially all around the country.
That's why on the road I can't. You know, I eat a pot cookie at night. You know, listen, at night when I smoke, I don't even get high no more.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, like if I smoke at night after a show, my adrenaline's so high, I'm just smoking to smoke. I don't get high till I go back to the hotel room and relax an hour, and then I can take two hits off a joint and get high. But it's like trying to fucking drink alcohol when you're doing blow. You just burn right through the alcohol. The alcohol doesn't even affect you.
Does it burn through edibles the same way or not really? Edibles are too strong.
Edibles come and go with me. You know, I haven't done edibles since when we did them.
Really?
Tuesday. Yeah, I don't have them in the house no more. I had bags of them. I do not have them at the house no more. I mean, listen, we're eating fucking 800 milligrams. What's the cheapest you're going to do at this point in the fucking game? It's
right.
180. You know, if you're not batting around me, 200, 300, 400, I can't hang with you no more. We banged out 8 last week. We walked out of here like gentlemen. I mean, I was fucked up. I went home and drooled and passed out and fucking, but, you know, your tolerance goes up. So what are you going to do? Like today I went over to Sunset Herbal and they didn't have any of the punch chocolates.
Oh.
They had stars and stuff, but I like giving the stars a break. So when I get the stars, they're brand new to my system. If you always eat stars, then the resistance goes down also.
So, if they make weed legal in California, you're still going to do the medical? Like, go through the whole process of going to the doctor?
Well, what would be the difference?
Because the only difference I've heard is that in Colorado, they have very low amounts of THC in the edibles, like 5-10 milligrams.
Where, in Colorado?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's 10 milligrams.
So that's not going to do, you'd have to eat the entire store. There's no way that's going to work.
When I went to visit Colorado, okay, I went to the store and I went to the recreational side, and that's the strongest you could get because somebody flipped out and put a cape on and tried to jump off a fucking building or something like that.
Yeah.
So that's what happened. But, no, I can't constantly be fucking high all week. So now I spread it around. You know, I've been noticing that when I eat edibles at night, two things happen. A, if I'm up at midnight, I feel bad for what's in the refrigerator.
There's no chance.
Those fucking stars will take you to a next level, take your hunger to a next level. And B, I dehydrate while I'm sleeping.
Fuck yeah, you do.
So that means I got to get up every 2 hours to drink a gallon of water, and that means what comes out of my dick is a gallon of water. So that means zero sleep for Uncle Joey. So I got to be careful with the edibles. If I eat edibles, I got to eat them like at 6. So at about 12, I'm okay, so I don't wake up. Sometimes I wake up at 4, and I'm fucking hammered. The room is green and shit. I'm hungry. I'm having dreams and fucking cartoons. I'm fucked up, guy. But I'm also thirsty, and I dry up. So it's like that first night in Vegas. I ate two stars before I went to bed. Big mistake. At 3 in the morning, I was right then in the middle of that edible. The anxiety in my sleep woke me the fuck up.
You have anxiety in your sleep?
Oh, my God. Twice.
Like a dream?
You have a. It's just anxiety in your sleep. You actually wake up and you're having a fucking panic attack.
Fuck.
Because I ate the edible at 11 o'clock at night, that Thursday night when I got in. Like a shush that I am, like a fucking moron. So at 4 in the morning, think about it, 4 hours in.
Oh, yeah, it's just starting to kick in. Yeah.
It fucking woke me up. My heart was beating irregular, it's dry, I can't fucking breathe out of my nose.
I never used to get anxiety, but at least like the 800 milligrams, I start getting really weird anxiety. I thought that Paula was going to have her brother come and kill me, just for no reason. I was like, that's why she's dating me, so her brother can come and kill me. And I was probably on like 500 milligrams. That's where I was. I was on 500 milligrams in Big Bear with the elevation, and I wasn't ready for it.
Oh, no,
and I had like 500 or 600 milligrams, and I was like, she's going to fucking kill me. Like, as I was going to bed, I was like...
You have to be careful in the higher elevations, man. That's fucking crazy. The higher elevations will, with THC, that's why on a plane you get whacked. You got no air.
That was. I've only done that once with you, and that was fucking scary.
It's scary. I calmed it down a little bit, because I don't want to have to take a plane down by myself. I just have a panic attack up in midair and go, you have to take this plane down. I'm having a panic attack. I don't have no leave. I don't have no whatever for my nose.
What do you panic about?
I have no idea.
It's different every time. Sometimes for me, it gets similar. Like, I think people are mad at me that aren't mad at me.
The first time I started getting the worst panic attacks was when I was going to that kickboxing gym on Burbank Boulevard. It's a small place. So he used to play music. And between the kids going, ha, ha, and the fucking music bouncing off the walls, it would go into my ear weird. And it would get me a weird anxiety. Do you know that?
Would you be high or no?
Sometimes I'd go in there high, and I'm like, what the fuck is going on? I have to go out and get air. Because between the music... One time I got a bad dose of anxiety inside McCormick & Schmitz in San Jose. I was in the back of the restaurant, and I thought that if I would have walked through the door, I would have had to pass out. It's fucking horrible, but I don't give a fuck. Listen, it's something that you live with, you remember to breathe out of your nose, and you just move on. That's what I always do. I just remember to breathe out of my nose and see where I am and get my focus and fucking move on. Why fuck around with it? That's all it is.
I just tell myself that it's the weed. You just breathe and that, and it just calms you down?
That's it. Just keep breathing out of my nose. Look straight ahead. Don't look at the floor, because that means you're looking from within. So look straight ahead and keep breathing and maintain your posture and think of something that, you know, and sometimes you'll think of something and that'll take your mind right off from you breathing. Like, oh, shit, I remember I got to go to dry cleaner. And all of a sudden you start thinking about the dry cleaner, how it closes at 5, and next thing you know, you got your center back, which is what you're always striving for. And at the end of your center, always swallow.
Really?
Yes.
What happens when you swallow?
I forget what it does for you, but it restarts. It's like press and control alt.
Oh, okay.
So when you swallow like that, so that's what I do when I get those anxiety attacks. But I don't get them no more like that. I really haven't. I'm happy I slowed down on the edibles. I've been smoking a little more. I like smoking.
Really? I like edibles so much more.
I always like smoking reefer, since I like the whole product. What I don't do is smoke joints anymore. I don't smoke as many joints as I like. I like to smoke fucking bats and roll them. That's the whole patois. I'm an old-fashioned fucking douchebag, man. I like everything, you know. That's why, I tell you, my wife last Sunday thought I was upset about something. She goes, are you upset because Mike Dowd's coming in town? I go, no, as a matter of fact, I'm kind of fucking happy he's coming in town, because I appreciated him last week. I had a good week with him around, believe it or not. Regardless of what he had done or what hadn't done, I got a few emails. I got some fucking liberals that listened to the podcast by mistake and then went on this documentary and got the shock of their fucking lives and, you know, hit me up trying to ask me to justify why I would put a person like that on the podcast. You know, and I put a person like that on the podcast, the same reason why I go on a podcast. Because it's not about what you did, it's about what you did afterward. It's how you got up, you know? He didn't walk around in a fucking cave. He went out there and put it on Front Street, man. You know, so many people do weird things and they get in trouble. And then they live this charade. And I got to hand it to Mike. He's not living a fucking charade.
He is who he is.
He is who he is. Straight up. Took him to the Comedy Store. He was hugging people, giving out cigars, talking to people. He's just one of those guys, man. And sometimes in life, you know, you just do some things and they make you go sour. Who knows if it was him deep down inside, or the drugs, or the job, or whatever. I don't give a fuck. It's how he bounced back. You know, so many fucking people, especially here in this town, live in a fucking charade. You know, that they just live in this fucking zombo land. And some people, believe it or not, actually wake up, Lee. Some people never fucking wake up, you know.
From Hollywood or from what?
Well, you know, you have these charades in life when you're younger. What's going to happen? You know, you watch Pitbull and he's jumping up and down with 200 Spanish women. Or you watch, you know, whatever. Whatever your illusion, which it grabs you. Let me get one of those drops again. And you, you know, when I was growing up, I had this thing. I always had this illusion. And then it became a charade. It really became a fucking living lie for me, Lee.
You just started believing all the stuff you were saying?
Well, no, it wasn't what I was saying. And when I was like 17, I got it in my mind that when my mom died, that she had hidden money. And that when I was 21, I was going to get this money. And it was something that, it was either the money was hidden, or my stepfather was going to sell the house and give me this exuberant amount of money that I thought I had coming to me.
And so, and no one told you this. It was just in your head.
It was in my head. It was this fucking thing that just kept me alive. It was a lie that kept me alive, but at the same time, I would repeat it.
Do you remember where it started?
In my head.
But like right after your mom passed away or?
No. A couple of months later, maybe 3 or 4 months later, I started doing math and figuring out jewelry and cash and the fucking prudential policy that my dad left. And I had all the, you know, this property that she had in Miami. I had all this, you know, planned out in my head. And it just, and every time, and I, you know, every time I get coked up with my friends, I'd mention it, that in 3 years I don't have to worry about nothing. I'm going to be filthy fucking rich. You know, I think about people who have gotten caught up in the media. Steve Renazzisi had an incident, and I can't remember the other guy that had an incident that somebody called him out on this. You know, I had never called myself out on this. I mean, Lee, I believed it. I believed it in every step. I still remember going to Colorado, April of 83, and like that Christmas, still going, I'm going home, and I'm going to go to one and get my fucking $500,000, $1 million that's coming to me. I really thought, and I'm lying to you, I didn't put it in my head. What had happened when my mom died was that she left jewelry. She left his house. She left property in Miami. And my dad had a prudential policy. Not my stepdad, but my father, that she had never cashed and that was supposed to be mine. When you die without a will, it all goes to your husband. She died without a will. They were still legally married. So I thought that his generosity, somewhere in his world, he would go, hey, here, this money's yours. I knew for a fact that half the jewelry he wore was my real father's. The deal was, once I got older, he was going to give me the jewelry back. Like, my mother really believed that, you know. My mom sold me out at that point, but I didn't know these things.
Does that seem fucked up to wear someone else's jewelry? Like another, like, your wife's former husband?
It was the weirdest fucking thing.
That seems creepy.
It was really creepy. So it was supposed to be my fucking jewelry. And my dad had left, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of diamond rings and gold chains. And so you know, people would come up to me and they go, hey, man, you know, that money's yours. So that fed my...
I love when people do that who have no skin in the game, start riling you up. And you're a young kid who just lost your mom.
Well, I was 17.
That's still young to lose a mom.
No. But at this time, I knew better, but I got... And listen, we all make mistakes. At least, you know, I was thinking about Mike Dow last week and how this guy's not living a fucking charade. And I'm really proud of him. And I started thinking over the weekend about the charades that I lived. And that, like when I became a comedian, right? By the time I tried to get comedy, I could tell you right out, you're my friend and these are our listeners and we have family. We're all family together on this shit. I didn't get into this to be on television. I didn't have, you know what I'm saying? Where some people will tell you, I want to go to Hollywood and be a big time star. I never said that, Lee. Never, ever, ever did I say anything like that. I did comedy as just a last hope. You know, but there's people... I was telling somebody, and I could always tell when why somebody is in L.A. if they ask me about money. Once somebody asks you about money, they're not doing it because they love this game. And I didn't worry about money in them. I just wanted to survive. That's it. I just wanted to survive and not be in prison. And just, I wanted to just live life through the skin of my teeth. I would have been very happy.
When you were a kid, did you want to be rich?
No.
Really?
I didn't. My parents had money. My mom had money when I was growing up. And I didn't like it. Because I liked the kids that didn't have money. Like, I lived on 88th Street, and everybody on 8th Street wasn't millionaires, but they were well off. Everybody worked. Everybody did okay. I remember the girl I went to school with. Her dad was an animator for Charles Schultz. You know, all those parents in Midtown Manhattan in those days did something. They weren't fucking on welfare is what I'm trying to say.
Right.
Did I enjoy those kids? Yeah, I enjoyed those kids. But for some reason, looking back at it now, when years later, I remembered how much I enjoyed the kids from 148th that didn't have money. So when I would go into their homes and see that they lived in, nine kids lived in two bedrooms, I would get embarrassed. They'd ask me where I'd live, and I'd make up a story. You know what I'm saying? Like, I lived there with my cousin and my uncle and my aunt. It was basically me and my mom in a two-bedroom apartment.
That blew my mind when I first heard about that. About, like, families, like, kids sleeping on the couch for, like, ever. Like, that just didn't compute in my head. Like, I figured at least, at the worst, people just shared a bedroom. I could never imagine.
I know a family right now.
Yeah.
A husband, a wife, a girl that's probably 14, maybe 15, another girl that's 8, and a boy that's probably 6. Maybe a little older, but they all live in a studio apartment.
No, they don't.
Yes, they do.
At least I have that, I guess, but Jesus.
And I've known them since they had no kids. He gets rent controlled. I talk to him all the time. He gets rent controlled in fucking Hollywood. He's got two garages where he does his business out of. And he makes the best of it. I mean, you got to see this place. It looks like one of those micro apartments.
So what do? They just have mattresses everywhere?
They have couches, and they put beds in the wall to make the kids fun, so they pull the thing down. And he's like a woodworker. So, listen, the studio's like $550. He's been there for 21 years. And it's got a big kitchen, and a big bathroom, and a big hallway. But it's a studio apartment. And he took the closet and turned it into something else. And then one of the garages is the closet for the kids. So before they go to bed at night, they go to the garage and take their clothes out.
And the fucked up thing is, there's a lot of people in other countries that would love to have that. So, but it's crazy how, like, we get used to things and stuff like that. I can't imagine. And do the kids hate it, or they probably have a great time?
I feel embarrassed when I go there. I try to go there and check them out once a month, and I bring the kids stuff. And, I've known them forever. They came to my wedding with Terry. I've known them forever. He's African, she's Chinese, she's Japanese.
My whole, not I guess, dream as a kid was to be rich. Like, because I lived in a town like that where everyone else was rich.
When you say kid, what are the age?
My parents have a joke that from the age of 5 or 6, I was saying I wanted a job, an apartment, and a car. I've always been like that. And I've always, I don't know, man, I've always wanted to be rich. And it's only like in the last few months that I'm like, your goals change from being rich. Like, it's still important.
Well, you have to define. Okay, you have to get a pen and define rich.
I'm talking like,
what is rich?
Mansion
are
rich.
Are you working every month to establish this? Did you strike oil and somebody gave you $200 million and you invested $150 million and spent $50 million in a home and wife and cars and ranch? And
I always wanted to be like the CEO of something.
Okay, yeah. Do you just travel internationally?
No.
This is, you're a CEO of a company. Yeah.
I always wanted to wear like those blue button-down shirts with the white collar. But I never felt important enough to wear it like that. I want suspenders.
Okay, that's fuck it. All right,
yeah.
So you want to keep working? All right, I you know, there's people that say I want to be rich. Define rich. When I was 17, and I had that charade playing in my head that my stepdad was going to give me an envelope with $500,000,
right?
Without knowing, because I didn't know that then. I would have blown that in 10 days.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that define rich. What did you...
I want a mansion.
No, for me, I just wanted to get that money, get an apartment, get a fucking badass car, get some clothes, and I wanted to be the life of the party. That's define rich. That was my rich.
Okay, my rich was like a Cadillac, a mansion, because all my friends had them. Like, literally, everyone in my town had, like, the McMansion shit. And I had it was a nice, but it was, like, a two-story house and, like, a little landing with the bedroom. So it was a great house to grow up in.
I wanted money.
Yeah?
Like, I think everybody wants money. I just didn't want the douchiness and the shallowness and the self-importance that came with it.
That didn't hit me.
That's what destroys me about having $3. That you're supposed to act a certain way or behave a certain way. And that's what I didn't like about the Islam. Once I got here, I saw the people. You don't know what it's like to watch a movie and see somebody you like in a movie, you like them for years, and then you get to work with them and you get to work with them for a few weeks and you see how misbehaved they are as human beings. And you can't believe that this has been allowed around him.
And that you want it to be like him.
And that you want it to be like... It's very weird what you bump into. Once you see behind the curtain back in Los Angeles, it fucks you up. I always wanted money, yes. Part of it would go to a charity every month. I could live off a certain amount every month. You know, man, there's so many things you need. But then again, at the end of the day, there's so many things you don't fucking need. Like, I would hate to have $50 billion and to die broke. To know that I could have passed that money on to somebody and helped somebody do something. You know what I'm saying?
Right. And there's always good things you can do with it. But it was what you just said about people being douchey. I didn't realize it until I had a job. And I worked at CVS. And people would come in and be the worst. Like, so I purposely always got jobs in more lower middle class cities. And I loved it. And that's what it was. It's because, I don't know, when you're going to school and you're from elementary school, they're saying go to a good college so you can get a good job. My ultimate goal is to make money. But when you see the way these people act, and then you can go to the lower middle class towns and see people who are working minimum wage jobs for their entire life, so they're not going to have a lot of money, but they have so much fun at work. They invite you out camping. They invite you to their birthday. Like, that's, and people in my town would look at me like, why are you working over in Maynard or Framingham? And like, there's stuff you could do here. And it's like, I'd much rather, like, hang out. Like, those people are still my friends. It's, I don't know. It's, and I don't know what it is about money that does that to people, but.
Well, you see it a lot in Studio City. I see it a lot at the coffee shops when I meet people, people's behavior. You know, you just see there's certain aura to them. You know, when you go to the big casinos in Vegas, you know, when I mean a big casino, when you're going for a fight or something, and you see this guy that walks in and everybody's supposed to, that shit, you know, I like the guy that's a millionaire that acts like the guy that has $3. That's the guy I want to be. If for some reason I invented oil or some shit and somebody gave me $10 billion, I would still drive my Super Bowl. You know, I would like to dress a little nicer with suits or whatever, but that would last for a week. Until I got into a car and rip a pair of pants like a gorilla that I am. There's so many things that I couldn't be. You know what I'm saying?
Like 2 or 3 years ago, I think we were still doing the podcast in my apartment. You mentioned that you were thinking about getting a Cadillac. Why didn't you decide to do that?
Oh, because a guy from a Cadillac dealership hit me up and said that he works in service and they were really bad cars.
Oh, okay. I didn't know if it was a money decision. Okay.
No. Well, part of it was a money decision. I was having a child and I didn't want to pay $400, $500, $600 for a lease a month. I don't have anything to justify paying that much a month for a car for my lifestyle and what I do. You know, I don't need that. I don't need a $700 car payment. I don't understand that. I always wanted a car payment from being in the car business all those years. I always wanted a car payment that if something went wrong, I could always borrow it for 2 or 3 months. Like I've always said to you, I could come to you and go, Lee, I got a Subaru. Can I borrow $248 for 2 months? And I could probably get that from you. But if I come to you and say, I got a BMW 5 Series, can I borrow $750 from you for 2 months? You're going to go, it's time to sell that car, bitch.
Exactly. How many, speaking of people living in studio apartments in Hollywood, how many people have you seen driving one of those cars into a studio apartment or into a,
I've having seen four it. Roommates? I see people that fucking drive BMWs and Mercedes to take the train and park on the street. little things that's how you, if you really like that BMW, park it, pay to park in the fucking thing so nothing happens to your car. But you're going to save $36 a month, which is whatever the fuck it is, for something a fucking year to have somebody scratch your fucking car. It happens all the time on my street. The garbage can takes the garbage. They scratched my wife's rental car last week with the fucking garbage. Thank God she got the fucking extended payment. But that's not the situation at hand. At that age, at that young age, I had already put in my mind that I would hide the fact that my mother had money. When I would go upstairs, I would walk up 4 flights of stairs to go up to Cedeno's house, and they'd open the door, and I'd see bed sheets on the floor and a fan on for the whole fucking room. Are you fucking kidding me? And a TV with no cable. And the bathroom was the size, it was smaller than this office. 9 kids and 2 parents. I had a fucking, my own bathroom in 205 West 88th Street. Didn't have a shower. But it had a shitter and a sink. I'd have to take a shower in the living room. You know, by the living room, there was a big bathroom, you know, big, you know. But, and here I was going hanging out with kids that 9 of them slept in the living room in the summer in New York City in the humidity with all the windows open, with the fire escape open, listening to the streets with a fucking fan in the room. And meanwhile, I'm sleeping on 205 West 88th Street in a double bed with the air on, with a TV in my room, with a remote control, with a string on it in those days.
What was the string for?
The remote control had a string.
Really? It looks like all connected to the TV?
Box. Yeah, okay. Like a cable box. The old school cable boxes had a string. Do you know how guilty I felt? So every time I went up there, I would hide that I had money. I wouldn't wear the clothes my mom would buy.
Did you ever invite them to your house?
Not in a million fucking years. Not in a million fucking years. Not till I moved to Jersey did I bring those kids over because I had a swimming pool. And by that time, the cat was out of the bag. So I had my stepdad go over there, one of my mom's friends, pick him up, bring him over to Jersey. They all swam in my house 2 or 3 times. And I loved it. By that time, I didn't care. But when I was 8, I was already embarrassed of my mother's money.
What about when you moved to North Bergen and you told the story like the first time you went out and you were in the white shoes and the white shorts?
Oh, the whole fucking thing.
Like, what does that feel like as a kid? Seeing all the other kids in jeans and a t-shirt.
Well, even then, I knew that, like, when I moved to North Bergen, The reason why I didn't go out right away was because those kids looked clean. They looked cleaner than the kids I ran with in New York City. So I was like, fuck these kids. These kids are too clean. Once I went out there and got talking to them, then I realized they were dirty like me. But it took a while. But nothing. I mean, Lee, let's pretend. Let's pretend I get hired for a TV show. And the show goes 6 years. Do you think I'll get a BMW 7 Series?
Not a 7, but I, if no, before tonight, no. I would have guessed you might have upgraded your car.
No. I'll get the best Subaru.
The highest end Subaru?
In fact, I was going to get a wagon next week, my wife. We're going to get a wagon. She got this car back after getting hit. The lease is done in August. Fuck it. Let's go get a Subaru wagon. Let's go turn it in. She told me this morning she's thinking of buying it outright because she likes the car.
Wagons are great for kids. Just make sure you can get the one with the seat in the back if they still have it.
What's that?
Like, they have wagons where they put a seat in, like, the trunk area so you can face backwards. Oh, it was the best thing as a kid. My brother and I would fight for that seat.
That was 92 fucking
They must have it. Don't do that. They must have it.
Nobody sits looking out the window like a prisoner.
Oh, I love that.
Straight, cocksucker. No, I don't know. I don't know what they do.
It's called the way back.
I don't know. Yeah, no, there was two rows.
Yeah.
And there was one all the way in the back that the seat opened up that way. Sure, I remember. Fuck yeah. They used to put me back there because I get car sick. I knew a family who had that car. That was the way back. But no, the Outback, there's a couple of those station wagons. I couldn't imagine acting that way. I could imagine having a home, a nice home. With great security, a dependable car for myself and my wife. I like my wife to have help, but I don't need two babysitters and two house sitters and nannies. I don't need none of that shit in my fucking world. I don't like people in my fucking house, Lee. I don't like it. I just don't like it. Let my wife do the cleaning. I'll take the garbage out, whatever. Somebody wants to mow the lawn. I'm one of those guys, bro. I don't like none of that stuff. I don't like pulling up with a fancy car. I don't like people looking at me weird. Nothing. I want to be a low-key guy. How are you? Nice to see you. That's it. Don't even call me Mr. Diaz. Joe is fine with me.
Well, the fucked up thing is now you kind of stand out more here in L.A. driving a Subaru than you would driving a BMW 3 Series.
Why is that?
Because most of the people around here have that.
A Subaru?
A 3 Series or an Audi or one of those things. But do you see Mercy making those... noticing money or noticing kids who maybe don't have something yet or even being embarrassed? Does Mercy get embarrassed?
She's fucking three, Lee. She jumps up and down and she says she doesn't even know what she's saying. You have to teach your child to it's something that you teach your child, and people who listen to the podcast know what I'm talking about, that one of your parents sat you down one day. And they have to tell you, it's not about that. And we don't believe them. We don't believe them. It takes a certain age where we get hit in the face of reality. I got hit in the face of reality about money in 85 or 86 or 87 because what we're told is that you need money to have friends. You need money to have a woman. You need money to have a good time.
Happiness.
You need money to have happiness. And that is completely... a fucking farce. That is completely just a fallacy. That is completely a fucking fallacy. I know people who were broke and who were having a great time, and now they have money and they're married and they're fucking miserable.
How do you get over the stress of not having money, or do they just not have it to begin with? Like, the stresses that come with not having money, I think are what hold a lot of people back.
I had stress about not having money until I was about 30 years old. And then at 31 or 32, something happened that changed my fucking life forever. I lost everything. When I tell you everything, I tell you everything. You know, when I got out of fucking being locked up, I worked my ass off, Lee. I worked my fucking ass off, bro. Psh. 1987, 1988, 1989. I was born in 63. What's 89?
26.
I was 26 years old. From 89 to 93, I basically didn't stop. And two of those years, I did comedy. You know, in 1989, when I got out of that fucking hole, I came out with my feet and I planted them, and it was all, I didn't even give a fuck. I didn't even give a fuck. First job I had was probably detailing cars, but it took me 4 days to start selling blow.
At the dealership?
I had my own fucking operation. I was washing cars at some guys for commission. Plus, I didn't give them their phone. I had a pager. So I could be at Lee's house, and they would call me. And I would just have to leave your house and go to a payphone and call. And I go, where you at? In those days, there was no caller ID. I could say, I'm over here in the office. What's up? No, we just want to check in. Let us know when you're coming home on the way home. Okay, bye. That's a scam I was pulling. But I was leaving that halfway house at 7:30, and I wasn't coming back till 9. And, you know, once I got the, like, the first day I just went and set the shop up and got the buffers right and the inks right, and I made a few calls to fucking different dealers. They said, call these dealers and let them know that there's a detailer here, and they were kind of apprehensive. But then I got in my car and I went to all those dealers and started talking to them, and within a fucking weekly, I was working 7 fucking days a week. I was chilling out, fucking slinging that fucking powder like it was going out of style.
Where do you put money when you're selling coke? Like, do you just hide it places?
In those days, I was leaving at the dealership at overnight because if they searched me, I could only have $40 on me at a time. But when you're selling coke, you just hide it in your house. You hide it at your girlfriend's house. You have a partner. You hide it at his house.
There's no banks, right? You can't do banks at all.
You can do everything. People don't know nothing because you keep a day job. It's like they said in the 7-5, okay? So you have a day job. That day job gives you a check. With that check, you pay for your bills, your credit cards, your car payments, your mortgage, your rent, you know, that type of shit. With the coke money, you pay for the extras. But you're putting it away, you're hiding it. People know you got coke money. As soon as people buy coke from you, they know you're doing something with your fucking money. It's in your house, Lee. But after you get a certain amount, you move it. You know what I'm saying? You don't want $60,000 in your house. I don't want nothing over $3,000 in my house if I'm a dealer. I don't want them. I could always say I borrowed $1,500 from Lee and I was about to go to the bank and put it in there. I could always say I borrowed $2,000 from Lee and I was going to the bank to get it in there.
So you're a busy dealer, right? It's a Friday night. I don't know, make $10,000. Like, let's just say you're gonna make $10,000 that night. What do you do? Do you stop every three and go, or does someone come pick it up?
$10,000 cash profit.
Okay.
That's what you're saying.
Sure. $10,000. I'm just making the number up because I don't know what it could be.
I'm going to probably sell 2 ounces in grams on a Friday night.
Okay.
Maybe wholesale, whatever, two, and then sell an ounce wholesale, which I still make maybe $1,000 or something, maybe $800 or something like that. So let's pretend I make $10,000 on a Friday night. Profit? You hide it, Lee.
No, but you said as a dealer you wouldn't want more than $3,000.
Right. So you put it at somebody's house, somebody that you
But would
trust.
You stop during the night and like go drop it off? Do you think? I'm just trying to like because that's to me
you have to be very sly. It's a sly life. You gotta watch who's watching you, gotta know who knows your movements, you gotta have a friend that you could trust. You know, if I was a coke dealsman right now, guess whose house I would hide everything at?
Whose?
I'm looking at him.
Really?
Cash, scale.
Would you tell me?
Sure, I'd pay your rent, plus your car payment, plus your grocery bills. I'd pay for everything. I'd give you $2,000-$3,000 a month. Why wouldn't I? I wouldn't sell cocaine out of your house. I wouldn't have any powder at your house. I would just have a scale there with my phone numbers.
Would there be a rule? Like, would you be cash. Like, there no. can't be any parties here? There can't be...
Well, you got $200,000 in your safe. You want to have a party there and somebody takes you $200,000, now you got to come to me and say, hey, I have my friends over, Ashley and a Chinese friend, and now my $200,000.
Well, I don't, but there must be some idiots out there who are just like, no, I had a party,
no,
man.
No. But at least at different levels. Let's pretend, let me take you back, 1986, when I had that, I had a rotating $30,000 in the other house.
$30,000? $30,000. At any moment, there's $30,000.
Bandaged up at that house, $30,000 the whole time. And then I would have a revolving 8 or 9 on me. And I'd put 5 in there every fucking week, 5 or 10. So it'd be up to 40, 50. Then I'd invest in something stupid.
Like what?
Like, I'd go partners with you on 20 pounds of weed. Something that would take my time up slowly and give me my return back slowly. So I always knew I was making money. Do you know what I'm saying? Because sometimes it's just...
That's so funny that you called, like, buying a big amount of drugs like an investment.
Sure, that's what it is.
You're like an entrepreneur,
yeah.
I go
partners with you on something. So now you come to me and you say, I know a guy, he wants to buy fucking 2 pounds. He wants to buy 10 pounds of blow. I only have enough to cover 4. Cover 6 with partners. Let's do it. I didn't do anything. I just lent you fucking $6,000 or $60,000. And I became your partner. There's so many fucking things you could do, Lee, with cash. Especially now. I was stupid and young. I just put it under my bed and I had it bundled up next door. I didn't show it to anybody. Nobody knew it was there. I wasn't that fucking stupid. Nobody knew I had the money. My girlfriend at the time knew I had the money, but nobody else knew I had the money.
How long did it take you to tell the girlfriend?
She saw me making it.
Oh, yeah, that makes sense.
You know, every time I go over there and make one of those trips, let's pretend I'd make $17,000. I'd spend 7 and I'd put away 10. And out of the 7, I'd keep front money again. So I'd probably keep $3,500 again for my next batch. There's so many fucking things you could do. And then once, Lee, I never really made money. But let's pretend I'm a guy that's making...
What do you mean you didn't make money?
I made chump money on coke. Let's pretend you're moving like Adrian Diaz. He's making $1 million a month. Now we got a problem. You got to wash that money. You got to figure out how to fucking clean that money. You got to put bodegas, hot dog stands, and you're going to have the most lucrative hot dog stands in the history of America. Each hot dog stand's got to make 15 grand a day.
Did you ever do what they did and go to a casino?
No. I did it a different way, but I never really... That's how dumb I was, Lee. I mean, they took the money and went and exchanged it for hundreds. I didn't even do that. You know what I would do with money? Lend it out. I've always loved lending money out. For juice. Love it. Love it.
See, that seems like the most stressful one out there because you have to worry about people giving you your money back.
No. You come to me and go, Joey, you know what? I want to open up my own studio. Got 4 podcasts going in there already, blah, 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 blah. What would you charge me for $30,000? I'd say give me $1,250 a week until you give me the $30,000 or the $300,000, whatever. So I just milk you. You just keep giving me $1,250 a week for fucking until somebody gives you a lump sum of $300,000, then you pay me.
Fuck. Yeah, but what if people don't want to pay? I mean,
they always pay, Lee.
But no, they don't.
Yes, they do.
What about all these people losing their houses, though?
Oh, those people. No. I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about Shylock people.
Well, yeah, but...
When you come to me as a man and you go, I need to borrow $50,000, I'm going to pay you interest. There's people that make a living. People don't want to know. A lot of businesses can't go to a bank and borrow money. So they borrow money on fucking juice terms. And you got to pay the fucking juice, Lee. Right now, when you see those... what do you think all those fucking things, those ads are for? Get cash quick.
Oh, yeah.
The fuck you think they are? They're legal loan sharks.
Oh, right.
They're legal loan sharks.
What is it called? Cash checking? Or
All that shit. They're legal loan sharks. Legal that you sit there and go, I can't believe this is happening to me. Tomorrow, go to Zales. Tell me you want to finance Paula's ring.
Okay. It's not a good idea.
Oh, see how much you pay for that fucking doozy at the end. If the ring is $1,000, you're going to pay $18,000 after 3 fucking years. They vig you to death on that shit. It's 26% interest.
From the beginning?
Fuck yeah. They tell you zero down. No payments for a year. Ooh, what do you think that first payment's going to be at 26% interest? That's a lump sum, Jack. Don't believe the hype. Don't believe the hype. They're just giving away charity and we're just going to give you a fucking ring for Paula. Get the fuck out of here. We're going to make you pay for it. They specialize in that shit. That's how they get you, financing the engagement ring through them.
Well, everything is fucking like that. Like the flowers at Valentine's Day and flights when it's the holidays, it's crazy that we let people do this to us. Like gas, the craziest thing I ever heard about gas is like people, gas stations buy it, right? And then they put it in the tanks, and then the gas price fluctuates. But if it goes down, if it goes down, we don't get the lower price. They can still charge us whatever they want higher. So, it's crazy how much.
In other words, we're getting fucked, Lee.
At every end.
That's right. And once you accept it, it makes your life a lot easier. Then you have to decide on how many people you let fuck you. Do you understand what I'm trying to say to you? That's a complete different story. Every day I see somebody on Twitter complaining about a different corporation, whether it's an airline, DirecTV, fucking the cable people, what's the people who do the fucking wiring, AT&T. There's always somebody bitching on there for a reason. You know, they're not fucking around no more. And the thing about corporations is nobody accepts responsibility. Email us and we'll get back to you. Email who? Who am I emailing? I don't know. Email problems with terminal, whatever. It's AJG.com. And all of a sudden somebody sends you, thank you for trusting in us. You know, review of your flight itinerary. We're not going to be able to return the miles. And you're sitting there going, I sat in the airport for 9 fucking hours. Nothing? And that's what they do. Nobody. Who can I talk to? There's a general manager. Who? And they put you on hold. That hold is a strategy for you to hang up aggravated. Whether it's Bank of America. You ever call Bank of America and try to figure out what's going on with your account balance or whatever?
And yeah,
that's an hour.
Every time I get a credit card from them, someone steals it.
That's an hour.
I've just told them to stop sending it.
That's an hour. An hour. An hour of your day. So hopefully somewhere along the line you just hang up and go, fuck my $36. I don't give a fuck anymore. This is not worth the aggravation.
How much money do they make on the mail-in rebates? Like my dad made a point and be like, you have to send those in because no one sends them in.
You have to. I send them in, and they still give you. By the way,
the
receipt. You didn't send them the right receipt. You didn't do the right paperwork. Sprint used to be the king of that shit. Buy something, we send you a fucking thing. It's 90 days. You got to wait 6 months for your cash. So you got to wait 90 days before you send in. It's another 90 days to get processed. Are you going to wait for your $60? You're just going to rip up that paperwork. What am I doing all this shit for? No, listen. It's you get fucked at so many different levels, and you don't even know it. You know, cell phone bills, this, that. But the funny thing was, what I wanted to talk to you about was what we're talking about in the beginning about charades.
Right.
The charade I had going on and how I got rid of it. You know, I had that thing going on for years, Lee. And anytime I get coked up with somebody, it was pathetic. I was fucking pathetic, Lee. I would go on how Juan was going to give me $500,000. And after every shot, I would lie and say it was going to be $550,000. You know, and it went on and on. And it went through 1981, 82, 83. And then I came back. And at that point, I said, well, I actually went to see him one day.
One.
I go, hey, can I talk to him? He's like, yeah, what's up? He goes, hey, man, you didn't sign that paperwork for him? I go, listen, don't worry about nothing. What are we going to do about this? Like, I went there like I had leverage. Like, I went there like I had something coming to me. And this is the wrong guy that talked like this. But it worked because after that conversation, he goes, well, why don't we do this? Why don't we look for you for an apartment somewhere around West New York? And why don't we go get you a car this week? And he goes, go find the car. I'll put $10,000 down and you make car payments. And do you know, Lee, I looked at him and I was like, are you fucking crazy?
What?
Uncle Joey don't make car payments. I go, buy me the car outright. And he's like, I'm not buying you the car outright. I said, buy me the fucking car outright. Well, we got nothing. What are you talking about? That was the end. He said, I ain't buying you the car outright. Now you got nothing.
He was going to give you an apartment and a car at 17? And you said no?
I wasn't 17. I was 21.
Oh, 21. Jesus.
And this is after I sent 80 people to talk to him. This is after my mom's friends talked to him. This was like a fucking 2-year thing. And he kept saying, I ain't going to help him. He's fucked up. I kept hearing all these reports about me. And it went on, it went on, you know. Once he told me he wasn't going to pay for the fucking car, I told him to go fuck himself. And I went on a fucking tirade, Jack. Now it's like he's going to have to give me $1 million. I'm going to take him to court. I went in my mind on that one. And it was just a drunk, cocaine-ranted lie. I was putting through my fucking veins, man.
Why did you say no?
It's break time, bitches. Ugh, trying to hit this little fucking perennial OG. Lee, did you? I know you got the flu. You didn't get high tonight on that shit.
What are you talking about? I didn't get high.
This is sensational, Reefer. Like I was saying on Periscope, the last 6 weeks I've been smoking some very, very good Reefer. And I know that sounds like a very loserish thing to say, but I like my marijuana. If you drink a good beer, you tell your friends, man, I got this great draft ale last night at whatever the fuck. I've been smoking some very good marijuana lately. I'm very proud of that. I just figured I'd let
you know for a second.
So this charade went on. Lee, I kept fucking telling myself, oh yeah, he's going to give me $500,000. I'm going to buy a bar. Oh, you should have seen the lies I was telling myself, boy.
Ooh. And how? And this went on till 30?
This went on till I was possibly... No, I'm going to tell you what really happened just to fucking crack you. This went on till I got fucking just living under the rocket ship. Under that rocket ship was where I came to my realization about my life. Because what was going on with me was I was in pain, you know. I was, what's that word? I was frustrated. And to add all this, I added fucking cocaine to this. And then, guess what happened? All these three things met something that fucked me up, Lee. Reality. Dog, when I was 21, I got a dose of reality. That was so scary to me. But today, I'm happy I got it served to me. It was like getting a dish of poison. You know what I'm saying? It's like somebody serving you a bad dish and you getting sick. It took me fucking 5 months to get over that sickness.
What happened?
I went off the deep end. That's how I ended up in the rocket ship. I got hit with a dose of reality. I came to the conclusion, dog. I came to a couple conclusions, okay? I came to conclusion number one, that I wasn't getting no money. But now I was in a deeper dilemma. For the last fucking 10 years, I'm telling all these idiot friends of mine I'm getting $500,000.
Would you say that?
So now I'm going to look like the asshole that I really fucking am and the loser that I really am. You know, I'm not getting no money. Why have I been saying this stupid fucking lie for 5 fucking years? Why? Why, Lee? Why do people do this to themselves? Here I was, a young kid, just lying to my fucking self that I had this money coming to me. I had nothing.
Makes it easier, I think, than to face it.
Oh, my God. When I finally broke the news to myself, you know what I'm saying? Like, I had to break the news to myself that, Joey, you're not getting no fucking money. It was traumatizing. When I got the news that I had to go work for a fucking living, it was traumatizing.
Do you think people were talking about it? Like, when you would say, oh, I'm going to get this money, and you would leave, people like, he's not getting any fucking money. He's fucking living under a rocket ship.
No, because they knew the stories. You know, people knew the fucking stories about how me and my stepdad and all this shit. But I just couldn't handle it. I just fucking lashed out, and it broke me down for 4 months. But that charade did that to me.
Fuck.
That fucking charade. That's why whenever I see somebody living a charade, and you know it. You know it because you lived it. I lived it. And we all live charades at some part of your life or another. You all go through a little minute of it where you go, what am I fucking crazy? I just got thrown out of the South Point. I got banned from the South Point. Why am I hanging out with Joey Diaz for? No, but that, I'm just saying.
No, I mean, I get it.
It's very, it fucked with me.
Yeah.
And then something really weird happened to me after that whole thing went down.
Okay.
I stopped talking to my stepdad, you know. I made a deal with myself. I said, you know what? At this point, I'm taking the story out of context. Because what really happened was I started hanging out with George. And George Kaladinsky had a friend named Sammy. And one night, me, Sammy, and George went out into the city and we picked up an eight ball. And about 3 a.m, we're fucking hammered. And Sammy looks over at me. He goes, "You know who I am, right?" And I go, "No, I don't." And he goes, "I thought that he told you that we, our families kind of know each other." I go, "Yeah, yeah, kind of." He goes, "Well, anyway, a lot of people don't know this, but," he goes, "I'm getting fucking $10 million when I'm 21 years old."
Just out of the blue.
Out of the blue. And he just started telling me the story and how his father was a bookie. And it's a true story. I mean, they even had it in the New York Daily News. It was fucking real. There was a Spanish team that they were a boyfriend girlfriend team that were killing people, like setting them up.
Oh,
and they killed the father in his own house, and he hit the alarm, and that's how the cops came. And but to make a long story fucking short, he always said he had a will coming. And I remember being coked up with him and him telling me all this and me looking at this guy. And I remember that whole time what I was fucking doing. Like, that was the same story I was telling. Like, that was my violin when we did Blow. You know, that was my little, "You want me to bring you guys down? Let me bring you guys down. My mom died and I'm getting this fucking money." And there was no fucking money. But, you want me to tell you what happened to that kid's money?
Yeah.
He did get money. He didn't get it. His family got it. And his mother donated it to a church.
That would fuck you up as a kid, but that's a nice thing to do. As a kid, like, you must hate your mom a little bit.
Me? Or?
Well, he must have, yeah. I mean, it's a great thing to do, but if you've been thinking you're going to get $10 million, it goes to the church. The whole thing.
It was horrible for me. It was a horrible... And that's why when I see people, whether it's... The other day I was at Marie ETC. I'm minding my own fucking business. And there's this girl up there I see every 9 months. Now, I should not say this to you people, but I have to. Because I have to fill in the fucking story. Doesn't matter what color she is or what nationality she is. She's not the best looking girl in the world. And she's a nosy Rosie. She's one of those nosy Rosie types. And she's a comedian. And between you and I, she's fucking horrendously bad. She's awkward. Very awkward on stage. And I've seen her. She's been here for 15 years. And nothing has happened for her as a stand-up. But whenever I see her, she always stops, comes over, and tells me about what she's doing. And I know it's all bullshit because she's living a charade. I can't tell her that. I mean, she's still doing extra work, Lee. She's still doing fucking extra work 15 years later.
For $100 a day.
I don't know what they pay, but she's like, "You know, I need one more voucher." 15 fucking years you've been an extra. And she told me she did a movie with like Matt Damon, and he told her he was going to put her in the new movie, and she never heard back from him, and the new movie shot. You know, Lee, when you buy into that shit and you've been an extra for 15 years, do you know what I'm saying? I could have said something. I won't, because she has a dream. I can't. But at what point do you realize you're running a fucking charade? Am I supposed to say something? I'm not going to fucking say nothing. It's not my business. Maybe people looked at me 10 years ago and thought I was running a fucking charade.
Well, like, I've been thinking about that. Like, at what point, everyone's goal is to be successful. At what point do people stop? Like, I rented a car, and the dude who rented me the car was calling me sir, and he was probably older than my dad, and it made me feel like garbage. And I was like, what age is he okay with being that doing that? And, like, at what age do you admit that you're doing a charade?
I wasn't doing a charade with comedy. I was just doing comedy with no end. I never thought I would headline. So I always thought I would be like that feature act that would become a great feature act with no credits and nothing like that.
But did you want to headline?
Looking back, I don't know. That's how out of the loop I wanted to be. I just wanted to have a fucking job, Lee. I didn't know if I wanted a headline because I didn't know if I wanted what came with that. And when I say headliner, there's two types of headliners. There's the guys that just headline C rooms and D rooms. They make an okay living. I'm not putting nobody down, but they're very content with that. There's guys that do comedy and they want to push it a little further. They have a, they want to be on Saturday Night Live. They want to be on Mad TV. They want to be on a show, whatever the fuck they want to be. That's why the whole purpose is when you, when I asked you, people say they want to be rich. Again, it's just like fucking doing goals. Okay, so you want to be rich. And I spell rich with an R. That's how stupid I am, right? Is that how you spell it?
Yeah, rich. R-I-C-H.
Not W-R-I-C-H?
No, you're okay. Right.
Rich. Okay, you want to be rich. So how do you claim to being rich?
Okay.
That's what I never knew. I thought you became rich. I thought I was going to kick down the door and bump into fucking $2 million. That's how dumb I was. That's how pathetic I was all those years. Like, I was like a... like a lottery ticket guy. Like, there's lottery ticket people who play it for amusement. There's people who play the lottery and think they're really gonna fucking win. You know, Pat Benatar had a contest one year where she was gonna get married in Hawaii. I bought 1,000 postcards. I sent postcards to MTV from every fucking mailbox in New York City and New Jersey. I didn't even win an album because it was like one lucky win and a friend go to Hawaii. 500 people get like an autographed picture and an album. Another 500 people get like a fucking album. Another 100 people get like a t-shirt. I got nothing. I swear to God, I bought 100 fucking postcards. I'm lying. I didn't buy 1,000. I bought 100 fucking postcards and I licked a snack and put them on every one of them. I actually thought I was going to win that fucking thing and go to Hawaii and I was going to yell at the wedding like an asshole.
Like when they asked if anyone has anything to say? You were going to say you want to marry Pat Benatar?
Yep. That's how fucking stupid I was.
That's fucking insane. So wait, and your plan was to propose to her?
Dog, I was living in a fucking planet.
Oh my God.
Between the drugs, the fucking weed, my fucking single child bullshit, I was living in this fucking fantasy world, bro. And when I broke out of it at like 25 or 26, it was mind-boggling how much pain it was to break out of that fantasy world. I had this fake cushion I was living. Jesus Christ, look at that. I've never admitted that to nobody. Like, I was going to go to Hawaii. There's so many fucking mind fucks I had. There was one particular mind fuck. February of 1984, one of my biggest mind fucks, 83. I was going to rob this bookmaker who had a closet filled with cash, Lee. When I tell you a fucking closet, you know those shelves for towels?
Oh yeah, linen closet.
He had like fives, tens, twenties, fifties, hundreds. Like in the fucking closet.
That's my dream.
Okay, that's what he had. That's what he had in the fucking closet. You would go over there to pay a bet and he'd make change, open up the closet and take the change. Who hides money in a closet? That's how much cash he had. And people knew it. It was well known. But he was such a badass. In my mind, I was going to break in through the back fucking window because he went to his real house on the weekend and they would leave the cash there over the weekend.
He would, oh my, fuck.
That was the word on the street.
That's a fuck, that's like a, what is that to you? That's like a stake to you.
I almost, that was one time that I sit there and I go, I should have got shot. But he didn't get his gun.
Oh, he was there.
He was there. He even opened the curtain.
Fuck.
And he looked right at me. I had like a half a mask on. And at that point, I heard the cops. And I started fucking running. I jumped over the fence and I got away from the cops. I ripped my hand open. That was a scam. I actually thought that I was going to like move to Jamaica and smoke weed with the Stones till I was 90. You have these illusions when you're a kid. I had these, and I thought money was going to solve all of them. Okay, that's what I thought. You hit your nail on the head before. I thought money was going to solve fucking all of them. And you know what, man? I remember getting in such a hole in 90. You got to remember, guys, this was a 10-year hole. Think of not having money for 10 years. No money. From 1990 to 2000, I basically lived hand to fucking mouth.
No savings account anywhere?
Nothing. And I'm not going to lie to you, in 93, I made money, you know, $60,000 one December. I made about 100 grand that year. I made some money, but from 94 to 2000, comically, I was picking up $50, $100 here. You know, there was, you know, in those days, a feature got $450, $350, $250. I wasn't making no fucking money. I was probably making
less than $1,000 a month.
Less than $1,000 a month from 95 to 2000. And snorting blow and buying clothes and child support and just putting it together, plane tickets. Then I met Terry. And she started lending me the little money that she had. We started pooling fucking money together. But 2000, I didn't have fucking no money. That's when people ask me, how long did it take you to make money? 2004, when I got the longest yard. That was the first, I mean, I had gotten a few paychecks, you know, Spider-Man 2 and fucking You Got Nothing. I did a bunch of movies that I got paychecks on that took care of things to the next paycheck. But the big paycheck that bailed me out was the longest yard. And that didn't bail me out completely. That just bailed me out a quarter. The rest of them had to suck my dick.
And so what happened at 30 that you stopped caring about being poor?
I hit rock bottom. I had something I never thought would happen. I just hit rock bottom. That's it. I lost all my credit cards. I lost my wife. I lost my job. I lost fucking everything. I had to start from scratch. Anyways. In 1991 and 1993, I started from scratch at the age of 30. So once you have a little dough, you make dough, you get locked up, you sell some drugs, whatever. Now you lose everything. Once you have nothing, you have nothing to lose. Nothing really affects me now. Nothing really affects me. I keep my rent low. I keep my bills low. I don't live like a fucking animal, you know. I'm not looking at my savings account. I just don't live like an animal. There's a thousand things I could do, dumb shit. I just don't do it. Not because I'm cheap. I just don't want to do it. I don't understand.
Is it a fear of losing it again, do you think, or no?
Not at all. I don't do blow. I don't do anything that I would lose it.
But you could lose it a normal way, just fucking the economy or fucking, I don't know.
What, the stock market? We're not stock markets. I go out on the weekend and make a living. A movie calls me up. I get union wages. There's nothing I could do about it. You know? Yeah, it's going to slow up. It's going to dry up, and you're always prepared. I don't care if you have $20 million. You're always concerned if you're going to lose your money or lose what you've worked for. But that's why you keep working. And you don't worry about it. I don't worry about it. I don't go to Aruba. I don't want to go to Puerto Rico. I don't want to do none of that shit. I just want to raise a healthy baby. I want to take her to Disneyland. You know what I'm saying? I want her to get over this fucking car sickness so I can take her to places. Beside that, you know, I'm simple at this age. What do I want? For 10 years, I lived in this hell. I thought that you needed money. I really, really thought that. You needed money to be accepted. You need money to be liked. You need money to have friends. You need money to have a woman. If you need money to have any of these type, get rid of them. If you need money to have friends, then don't hang out with those dudes. You know, in 84, one of my biggest mistakes was my friends had money.
Why was that a mistake?
Because every time I ran with them, the dinner, I was broke. I was broke after the dinner. Never mind the eight ball of blow and the dancing and the drinks and the Heineken on... And a bottle and a shot to fucking Cuervo tequila and, you know, the parkings and all that shit. So when you hang out with people, I was trying to be one of them. That was part of my charade. Don't worry about nothing. I'm getting $10 million in a couple of months. I'll be buying champagne for everybody. That was part of the fucking charade, Lee. Fuck. You ever hang out with rich people? Yeah. You got to act a certain way. You got to do things a certain way. If they go somewhere, you got to go somewhere. They can't know that you don't really get money from your dad. They don't know.
See, I wouldn't do that.
Me neither. But there's people who do that just to have those type of friends.
Because that's what I was going to say. The one thing that does bother me is when I know people have money and like when they try to split a check item by item or like they or real like they get real, especially at dinner. That's always when it bugs me. Like they're like they don't want to pay for certain things or just split the check. It really bugs me. And it's always those people. And those people are the people that don't tip either. I've had people with American Express Black Cards not tip me.
Lee, that's why they have money. Because they act that way. Let me give some shout outs here real quick. Where do we start? My main man, Elliot Frazier, Nikki Power, Frank Berdiri, Berdini, whatever your fucking name is. You know I love you, cocksucker. Yost Parrish, Mike, Chris Zotis, Adam St. Clair, Josh Stark, Christopher Reitz, and Paul Vogel. I love you guys. Don't forget San Jose next week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. I think that's the 11th through the 13th. Then I'm at the Tembler Brewing Company in Bakersfield on the 19th. Then I'm at the Brea Improv, March 31st through April 2nd. Get your tickets, bitches. It's been a nice couple. Fuck, February was a nice month.
Hell yeah.
Wasn't that bad. I got to work on Marin for a few days. Excuse me, we did that show at the Belly Room last Wednesday. Thank you if you came out.
How'd it go?
Honest to God, I always talk about the original room. The Belly Room is a fucking powerhouse little room. It was Steve Simone. It was my man Rogan. And then I went up. We were out of there by 9:30. Eleanor Kerrigan had a showcase at 10. She was taping up there or something. I seen Dice's kids. It was great. It was great. It was a great little time. That's the first night you got sick.
Yeah.
Mike Dowd came down there with us. It was great. I have no fucking complaints.
That's awesome.
You know, I keep it simple, Lee. I'm getting older. I get tired. I keep it simple. You know, the Savage Dad Tour, I'm putting the rest of the dates up. And after that, that's it. I got to fill in Chicago, which is October. I'm only going out 2 weeks a month, some months, maybe 1 week a month. July, I got nothing.
Oh, you're taking July off?
I think so.
That should be fun.
Well, maybe not. You know, I'm just saying, for right now, I got to find some. I don't want to go to these places once a year anymore. I want to go once every 18 months so my material's solid for them. So I defeats the purpose if I go once a year, every 11, 12 months. They hear 30% of that fucking material. I don't want them to hear that fucking material.
Right, like you haven't been to San Jose in about 2 years or something,
2 years, because for a while I was always in San Jose. And what you San Jose, Sacramento, and San Francisco, God bless their souls, but those motherfuckers drive. Then they come 2 months later and I got the same material, maybe 20 minutes different. I feel fucking insecure. I'd rather you not. So from now on, I'm only going to two places in the Bay Area. If you notice, I got San Jose and Sacramento. I don't have San Francisco on the books. I might just lay San Francisco one night only at Cobb's, like a night before New Year's or something like that, just to get in and out of there real quick, just to keep them in check. You know what I'm saying? You know, I love San Francisco. I really do love San Francisco. As a city, there's a lot of fucking cities I like, but I lived in San Francisco, so I've always had like this weird attraction to it. That night with you, with the dude, with the dog, to me was one of the funniest nights. If I have to rank 10 nights of my life, that was one of the funniest nights ever to me, with that dude running away and then he come back with the dog and he threatened us. Then the guy would come from the hotel and he'd go, excuse me, can you guys keep it down? We have people inside. The guy wouldn't be in the hotel 2 minutes. I'd start yelling at the guy again, come back, you fuck.
If you want, I can check. I think there's a chance I have it in my email.
No, leave it alone, please. That was fucking craziness with me, you, the kid from San Francisco. For some reason, the last year, people have been asking me about my life in San Francisco. It was fucking whack. It was whack. It was the wackiest 4 fucking months from when I was robbing people in the building. I was fucking selling drugs with Cubans. There was Cubans who were beating up gay guys. It was fucking horrid. It was just horrid. It's hysterical. If they ever make a movie of my life, they got to do those 4 months as just like comedy. It was really straight up fucking comedy, Lee. I would sit in a hotel with a newspaper and wait for tourists to go in and out. Then I'd follow the maid and take the keys out. In those days, the maids would go in, open the door, and leave the keys in the door.
That's the opening of the movie right there.
What's that?
You're just sitting in a hotel room, just sitting there with a newspaper. All of a sudden you walk up, find the maid, and just go in and steal something from the room.
Listen to me. In San Francisco, I lived in a room that the window faced the alley.
Right.
And the alley had four windows. It was just a shoot. And the black guy straight across from me was maybe 5 foot six, muscle bound but ripped. And he would put a thong on every night. And he would play Stevie Wonder music and just dance in his underwear on top of his bed. But he would dance seductively till 2 or 3 in the morning. I would open up my curtain, he'd be in there dancing. I mean, you cannot write this shit, Lee. I lived in a fucking, at the Virginian Hotel that is now the hostel. I was friends, I used to double date with the manager of the building and his wife. Me and my girlfriend used to double date with them. And they kept telling me at dinner, somebody keeps robbing the building.
And what would you say? That's terrible.
We have no idea how they're getting in. We've had about 8 complaints. We think it's one of the maids. It's got to be the maids. Who else could it be? They got the keys. But the maids, I would take in the key, put opening the door, and putting the key right back. I did this about 5 or 6 times, Lee.
So you only rob like one room a day?
I would play it off. But there was this old guy in the building. When I say old, he was my age now. He was about 50-something. And he lived towards the window at the fire escape. And he always locked his doors. He was a bookie. He did those sheets. But he never figured out that he lived on the first floor. All I had to do was stretch my leg and open his window. His window was always open.
Fuck.
So I'd open his window, jump off the fire escape, and then just crawl into his house, into his hotel room. And I would take some of the tickets. And I would take all the cash. And he was good friends with the landlord also.
Okay.
So they're all sitting there going, it's got to be the fucking maid. And I'm sitting there with the guy's money in my pocket going, how are you guys doing today? It was horrible until I got caught in a fucking hotel room.
How did that happen?
I don't fucking know, Lee. I went in the people's room. And the people came back when I was in their room. So I got the key from the maid, opened up their room, put it back, went in their room, locked the door, and all of a sudden I heard the key go in, and it was the people. They had come back, they had forgot like a camera or something like that.
That's fucked up. Well, your heart has to sink.
I was going to jump off the second floor. And then they sent the cops, and the cops opened up, and I said I was scared that I was taking a towel from the maid, and they started putting it all together. They caught me in a room. This wasn't good. I was the last guy they were looking at.
And this is where you were living too, or no?
You don't shit where you sleep. Rule number one that I broke. I was 21 years old. I thought I had the world by the balls. I thought I could get away with whatever I wanted to do.
You should have robbed your own room. And that way it would have made it look like it wasn't you.
I was in the room, Lee.
Yeah, but just say like something was stolen from my room.
They busted me, Lee. There's no getting out of it. They busted me. And then, like 4 days later, I lost the trust of the building a little bit. And then 4 days later, the German tourist that I had broken into their room got pissed off because the cops didn't arrest me. So they went to the embassy to press charges. So a cop called down there and told the landlord, hey, is he still there? And they were, yeah, we're going to be there in 3 hours to arrest him.
Oh, fuck.
So the landlord, who was my friend, came up and he goes, hey, just to let you know, the cops just called here. They're coming to arrest you. They're getting a warrant because that lady complained. I packed my shit, went downstairs and got on a bus. Right around the corner there was a bus. It was downtown San Francisco on the Tenderloin. I took a bus to Reno. I never told you about this.
I think we talked a little bit about the bus to Reno.
And there was a fucking Arabian kid in there, and he lit a fucking cigarette with tobacco, hash, and weed in there.
Right.
And this was when Reno was so backwards that I was trying to get rolling papers and people were telling me to get the fuck away from them because I would do 10 years. I'm not kidding you, Lee. We were talking about it last week. That's when we're talking about it. You fuck now, you should have reminded me. You're the producer.
This was last week?
Yeah, we're talking about this with Mike Dowd, how in Reno in fucking 85, they wouldn't even talk to me. I would go into stores and say, do you people have rolling papers? And they would go, get the fuck out of here. We don't even want people rolling papers in our store. They'll give us 10 fucking years.
Fuck. So where did you go from there?
I went back to San Francisco and just shot right back to the airport. and put my girlfriend on a fucking plane. And she went on a plane, and with the pretense that she was going to send me money to get on the plane before the cops got to me. It took her 2 days. I stayed at that airport for 2 fucking days. I lived at that airport waiting.
Before security?
This was way before security. And you could live in an airport for a month and they wouldn't say nothing to you.
Oh, really?
You could just go from terminal to terminal. Take a shower in there, prep your hair. I mean, there were no showers in there. You could take a Puerto Rican shower in the sink, wash your balls and your armpits. And I would shoplift food at the airport. It was fucking horrible. Wasn't smoking cigarettes then. I was smoking weed. I would go outside and smoke weed. I had a bag of weed with me at the airport. For 2 days, I lived at the airport. Then she bought me the plane ticket, and I came. I moved back to Boulder.
You weren't worried that the cops were going to find you at the airport? Like, they're full of cops.
It was a misdemeanor warrant, Lee. It's not like television where they put an APB on you at the fucking airports and shit. It was a misdemeanor warrant.
Do you ever get worried about going back to San Fran?
No, there's no warrant anymore.
Oh, okay.
It went away. It disappeared. I paid the fine. There was no fucking fine. I'm lying to you. But that was, you know, this is all part of it, Lee. This is all part of the fucking shit, you know. I'm happy that I haven't lived in the fucking fog like that for 30 years. No, yeah, 25 years, 20 years, let's say. I haven't been fucked up in one of those. But it fucked me up a lot. It does. And when the cold reality of the end of the charade comes, it's painful, man. You feel like a fucking asshole, but not really. You feel like you can't believe you pulled the wool over your eyes. It's like that. It's like my neighbor, the chick that was dating the young guy, and she really thought she was going to win him over at the end. You're going to be 80, and he's going to be fucking 50. Your pussy's going to drag to the floor. He's going to be filled up. You know, it's just, some things just don't fucking work. It comes up to, it's up to you to stop the fucking charade. You know what I'm saying? Like, it just, that's it. That's what we're talking about tonight, Lee. How you feeling?
I'm good, but it's funny you brought that up. Like, I've known for a while that diet soda is terrible.
No?
That diet soda is terrible for you. But, like, I just kept telling myself, like, I would stop. And then yesterday, I didn't have any all day. And I felt, like, I almost had to tell Paul, like, I wasn't going to go last night. And then I was like, wait, I haven't had a soda today. Let me have one. And then 2 minutes, I was feeling great. I was like, so I never felt that. Like, even when I was doing the juicing and I didn't have soda, I didn't feel that.
So you drank the soda, you drank
it? I felt great.
So, when you drank it?
Yeah, when I drank it. So I had not, like, people told me for years that it's terrible. I just was like, yeah, I know. And my answer was like, oh, well, I'm going to get cancer, I'll just get it this way. But I'm like, I felt terrible. I haven't felt like that in years. Like, I've never experienced that.
I'm not drinking soda?
Yeah, I felt like garbage. I felt like the flu was coming back.
You better get your life together. You understand me?
I know.
It's just caffeine and whatever the fuck else they got in there.
I don't drink anything else with caffeine, though, so that's why.
So you're going to quit drinking soda, or you're going to continue?
I'm going to quit.
When did you come to this fucking...
Last time when I realized that not drinking one for a day made me feel like I was getting the flu again.
And you're not even drinking soda with sugar in it.
Nope. Just diet. So that's what, like, the... And people have been telling me, and I know, and it just... And I love it, but...
Well, I used to always drink in the morning. People busted my balls. A guy on Twitter one day just sent me this fucking thing that was horrific.
Yeah.
What happens when you drink soda in the morning? That was it. I was done after that.
I know.
I didn't need to feel bad. You still go on the subway. You still do this fucking nasty
subway
shit.
Subway doesn't... I'm not going
to... Nasty shit, Lee. Nasty shit. All that stuff. You're a new man. It's little things. You got to close little doors before new ones fucking open. If you keep eating Subway, when does it end? When does it end? You know, every time there's a holiday, you go back to those creepy places. It's open. Places. All those places. All those creepy places. You see that? All those little wings you eat?
I didn't see that. There were
that fucking wing place where all rats. Did you see that article?
What wing place? No.
All those little fucking little wing places that you go to. What's the one you go to in Burbank?
Buffalo Wild Wings?
They were buying fucking rat.
No, they weren't.
Yes, they fucking weren't. All that. Like, I told my wife, I go, Lee Syatt wanted to do a fucking food show about food trucks. You should do a food show about where to get sick and... Eat shitty fucking food.
I don't
get
sick at places.
No, though. Because you're a billy goat. It's when you take somebody normal to one of your places and they get sick to death. You've gotten Paula hooked on that. She's got one of those stomachs, too. She's got one of those Mexican billy goat stomachs. You got one of those Jerusalem billy goat stomachs. And together, where'd you eat tacos at today? Someplace disgusting. Casas del Diablo or some shit.
Yeah, because he does tacos.
Yeah, sure, right. Somebody normal goes in there. They're shitting blood. They're yelping. They can't, they're seeing shit. You understand what I'm trying to say? Yeah.
I went back to Skinny Kitchen tonight, though.
How was that?
It was really good. They like have a whole bunch of new stuff.
What'd you get at Skinny Kitchen?
I got a grilled chicken sandwich with avocado and turkey bacon.
Good?
Yeah, it was actually really good. They have a whole bar there now. They have like a food bar, like a juice bar and stuff. It's nice.
You bad motherfucker. Yeah. Good month this month. Good month of podcasts. I'm happy you guys tuned in. It's been weird. We got the new studio. We finally got the fucking patois of the studio, as they say, and shit. Best thing about the studio is I could smoke fucking reefer. I come in here in the daytime and play fucking songs and shit. I still haven't figured out how to work the GoPro. And sometimes I just come down here just to check, because I know Lisa's going to check on if the studio's fucking all alone.
I'm here all day.
You ain't here yesterday. Everything. I came yesterday. There was fucking people lurking outside the fence. You know, I got to watch this place like a fucking hawk. But besides that, I'm good, man. I've been jiu-jitsuing steady. I've been stuck at fucking 299. That's why I didn't eat that fucking cake in Vegas. I got to check out myfitnesspal.com. It's really weird when you're responsible for something. I fucking, for the last year, I write everything in MyFitnessPal except what I eat after the night.
Yeah.
I keep that on my, but I never go overboard, you know, like I'll eat like two apples, or I'll eat like a fucking cheese sandwich on a piece of that thin fucking wheat bread or something like that. You know, nothing overboard. But even my jiu-jitsu is a thing. I go to BJJRecordsSomething.com.
Breakdown.
BJJ Breakdown, is it?
I believe so, yeah. Rafi's diet, right?
Rafi, no, that's a podcast.
Oh, yeah, but it's BJJ Breakdown. I'm pretty sure.
No, I forget what it is.
BJJ Journal.
BJJ Journal. Ever since I've been going, you know, the first thing I do when I walk in the door from jiu-jitsu is I go to BJJ Journal, and I write the move down we worked on, if I rolled, how my breathing was. Then they have a thing called mat time. And you click on to mat time. You know, when I fucking eat, same thing with MyFitnessPal. And I go through it at the end of the week, and I see what I ate, and then I remember what I ate that night, and I'm like, fuck. You know? And I'm still slow. Hey, listen, we're human, plus I'm 53. My metabolism is a lot slower. That's what I went online. I talked to a trainer friend of mine. He goes, maybe you have to do those HIIT workouts. But he goes, I really don't want you to do an elliptical every other fucking day. Because I told him I was thinking about doing your workout.
Why didn't he say he wanted you to do that?
Because he goes, I want you to fucking do more jiu-jitsu. I want you to go in the advanced class and roll more and get your heart going that way. I'd rather you do, Jesus Christ. Just thinking about it gives me the fucking, I want to shit myself. But it's great to be responsible, man. I don't know what goals you guys have or what you want to do, but log everything down. I log everything down. You know, and it's really weird. Weight Watchers teaches you that, to write everything down. And you look at it at the end of the week and you go, ooh, I went to Yum Yum's and I ate two donuts that night. And I went to fucking this place and I had a piece of Lee's cake. You know, sometimes if it's just two bites of a cake, I'll put a piece of cake. And I'll take the punishment for the carbs. Do you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'll put over carbs and over calories. Sometimes I go, the other day I went to lunch with Terry. And I took a bite of her apple pie and I put a whole slice down.
Just to make, over the calories.
Over the calories, yeah. You know, so it's really good if you log your shit down.
That's when my weight loss stagnated, really, is when I stopped doing MyFitnessPal.
Yeah. No, when I do comedy, I write down every set, how I did, and what's the new joke I tried, and what I think. And I've been doing this since 1997. I'm going to go on 20 years next year.
Do you have all of the notebooks?
I have the notebooks. I go all the way back to 2004. Terry wants to kill me. They're in a box. And I looked through them. I also have my auditions on record. And the main sheet I read. I have all my audition sheets. I'm sure a couple of them are missing. But I still got my Sopranos. I still got my Men in Black audition. I still got...
Do you write down if you get the role or something?
I write down if I get the role, how my audition went, how many times they sent me to go in to read, what I thought. You know, when I go into an audition, I look at it three different ways. Because I look at it for the initial read, the producer read, and the network read. So I prepare that on a sheet of paper. So I'll take a piece of paper, and I'll put lines through it and put, like, the name of the project is Gabriel. The casting director is Mick Foley. The date, and then what I'll do is inside I'll go to a separate page and I'll put the date of the audition, the casting director, who's directing it. I'll see what else he's been directing, the style.
Right.
If it's a TV show, it really doesn't matter because every 3 weeks a new director comes in if it's a network show. So it's not like he's going to imprint the style. But I always look to see if he's done films, to see what style of shooting he's got. And I write all these variables down, and I write the scenes. Like, let's say if I have to go to an audition, and there's three scenes. I write what is the scene saying? What the fuck is going on?
So wait, so like, let's say you get an audition for a movie, and you've never seen any of the movies this director has. Are you YouTubing clips of it, or are you?
Sometimes I just wiki his films and just see who he worked with, what genre. Where he came from, you know.
And does that change how you plan to audition?
Yes.
So, can you, like, two different directors? Like, I don't know, Spielberg versus Tarantino.
Okay, let's say, like, I auditioned for Spielberg once. And it was on tape. But this was so fucking badass that they called me. You had it, when you got the audition, they gave you a number, you had a call.
Okay.
You got to call up to the casting director, and she'd tell you exactly what he wanted and how he wanted and how he did not want any improvising. He wanted you to throw the three scenes down. So this is how to prepare him just to save you energy. Do not improvise. Do not go off book. You know, off book means he wanted you to be off book. No glasses. No improvising. No, none of your own words. This is how he wanted. It was for the show Tintin.
Oh, right, okay.
That show, Tintin. It was me, Sharippa, and some other guy. I think the other guy got it at the end. You know, I auditioned for Gus Van Sant. He did, you know, he was doing a Travolta movie, but now he had done, like, the movie about the junkie with Matt Dillon up in Portland, Oregon. I forget what the name of the movie is. He did that. I look at all those to see what genre, what I could get away with, what I could say. Ooh, if you work with that guy, I admire that guy. So maybe I could, you know what I'm saying? So that gives me a little insight into the project. But I write everything down. So when I go in there, I know this project. Now, in scenes, I just drew an audition out that I had. I don't know how I put it in this notebook. This is for a pilot, a CBS pilot. Okay? Now, this first scene in this pilot is scene number one. So it's two pages. And so what I do is I read this scene number one. It's this whole audition is seven pages. So it's probably three scenes. So this is the scene when I come into the donut shop and Arthur owns the donut shop and Franco is his assistant and, you know, blah, blah, blah. It's what happens in this scene, I write it down. What really happens in this
scene?
You
outline it.
So if I come in here and I say to you, listen, I got an opportunity of a lifetime. What's the opportunity, Joey? I'm going to give you in on my new fucking project. What's the name of the project? Dick Sucking Dick. Really, how much money do you need? I'm looking for $3 million. Even if we have a 20-minute conversation, I don't give a fuck about the conversation. I want to write, what's the fucking patois of this goddamn scene? What is really going on? So that's what I write for scene one, scene two, and scene three. So now when I go in there, no matter what happens, I know the character and I know what needs to come out of my mouth. You follow me? Because I could tell you, fuck you 80 different ways.
Right.
So no matter if I fuck up on it, I'm not really going to fuck up as long as I know the character that I'm reading and what direction where I'm going in this scene. And once she's feeding me lines, you follow me? So the first time I go into the audition, I know the lines, but I'm a little loose. And I take instruction. If the director, like, what's, there's a show on HBO that the guy's in love with his words. So was Milch on NYPD Blue. He was in love with his writing. You were not allowed to improvise in the audition. They wouldn't even look at your tape. A lot of writers don't like you improvising their shit.
Yeah, I can see it getting personal.
Okay, so some writers don't give a fuck. But you got to know that going in. So these are the little things you find out. You should always do a little research before you go in.
And do you call people, or how do you find that shit out?
IMDb.
It's going to say they don't like this?
No, let's say that it says on there, I go, oh my God, that guy directed Maz in the movie. I'll call Maz.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so I'll call somebody who worked with the fucking guy. And I'll find out all I can about him, or through rumor, or through interviews, or whatever. You read up on the guy. There's a show on HBO about I don't even know what the fuck it's about. But I went to read, and the instructions were that do not add a word into it. There's some auditions that don't really give a fuck what you say. But that's how I have every... The point of this was I have everything on paper, Lee. I could tell you how many auditions I went out for in 2008. I could tell you how many auditions I went out for 2009. I could tell you how many commercial auditions I went out for 2009. How many? You understand? This makes me stronger. Now I know.
Were you doing this when you had no money?
Yes. I was doing this in 1997. When I did have money, I had booked a Taco Bell commercial. But I figured I wanted to do 300 sets a year. Jerry West, one of the greatest shooters in basketball, used to start his day with 300 jump shots a day. So for some reason, I had that number 300. So my thing was to do 300 sets a year. That means basically if you do 300 sets, you have how many days in the year?
365.
So you have 65 days off. So that means you have Sundays off. And a couple extra days. But you should be on stage all those nights, right?
Yeah.
Because it's 52 weeks in the year.
There's a guy who did that 1,000 nights in a row.
Of comedy?
Yeah.
Yeah, oh, no. I did 80, 90. When I was first starting, I'd do 80, 90, 6, 7 months in a row every fucking night. You just went on there and found where there's an open mic. You didn't give a fuck. What do I care? Open mic. Go down there. There's three people with a ukulele or some fucking... Well, I used to do spoken word open mics in Seattle. There was a place on a Thursday at 7 right by the house, and I would go in there and do 7 minutes of comedy.
And you wrote down all those sets? I would love to read those. But has anyone ever seen them?
My wife, maybe. But she hasn't looked at them directly. You could tell the ones that I wrote when I was coked up. You could tell the ones that I wrote when I was straight. You could tell the ones that I wrote the day after. Because what I would do is sometimes I would write the set before I left. So if I knew how 11:45 at the Comedy Store, I'd write February 28th, 11:45 Comedy Store. And I left the notebook open, so when I get back in the door, I just fill it out. You follow what I'm saying to you? I tried a new joke, I bombed. Next time I shouldn't go out there this strong. Boom.
Do you ever review these? Or is it just the act of
writing it down? I look at the month. I look at the months now. I look at the months.
What does that mean? You do an overall month review?
I look at the month review, yeah.
What does the month review say?
I should get on stage more. Like this month, I should have gotten on stage a little more.
Fuck.
I think I did like 18 spots this month. Which I should be doing 25 right now. That's what record keeping does to you. Record keeping for and even for weight, you know, I got to start doing it for workouts. That's what I was doing it for workouts. That's what you got to do. When you got a notebook and log down Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and then write 4 days of this. Out of the 7 days, you got to do 4 days of 40 minutes on the cardio. And out of that, you got to do 4 days lifting weights.
Okay. And this is like, I don't know if it's self-discipline or commitment. That's
crazy. You have to write everything down. The power of the pen is so fucking important. That'll make your head goddamn explode.
If you couldn't write all this stuff down, what would happen?
I don't think I'd be as effective as I would. Because you have nothing to draw from. You have no guide. I can't gauge what I'm doing. And you have to write in there subjectively and honestly. Like, I didn't do well tonight. You know, I just didn't do well. My timing was off. You know, I read one from, the reason why I'm talking about this is I wrote the one, it's the end of the month. And I wrote the one from Valentine's Day where I wrote that I said, fuck a woman in the ass too quick on stage. I said it 3 minutes in. Why say something like that? Little things I write when I fuck up like that, so I read it and I think about the fuck ups I did. I can't listen to myself. That would really hurt my feelings. This is the closest I could do. But I have to be brutally honest with myself. If you're not brutally honest with yourself when you're record keeping, you're just cooking books. You're just cooking your own fucking books, so why are you even doing it? If you're just going to tell me that you did great, every night I did great, I killed, I lit that room on fire. Maybe in your world I lit that room on fire, but I did a set that I've been doing for the last 3 weeks. I got to knock that off. You follow me? That's what I write in there.
Where did this come from? Was this when you learned? Was this when you learned to write your goals down, or you?
I learned the comedy on my own. The comedy and the acting I learned on my own. I like looking back at things. I like looking back at things and see who you read for. Oh my God, I have a relationship with her. It's very important. I learned this from telemarketing. I learned this from calling people and not remembering why you called them and when you called them. And them saying, Pete, you called me last week. Fuck. You know, I didn't write it down. So when I call somebody now, I write 2/29/16, 2 p.m. I spoke to Lee Syatt, and we discussed next call. I don't do this anymore with calls. Don't trust me, I'm not selling nothing on the phone. But if you're doing something on the phone, you should keep this. So when you open up to his file, at least you know what your conversation was with him.
Right, no, yeah, it's interesting when, like, yeah, if you have repeat customers.
You should have 3 or 4 notebooks at all times. One for your weight. You know, well, I have my fitness pal. And that's for what I eat. And then, you know, the jiu-jitsu, whatever's for when I. The most important thing I do on that is I write the move down so I remember the move. Put your hand down, do this. And I also I write the amount of times I went in a month. And I try to beat the time before. You know, because that's what you're always trying to do when you work out. You're trying to beat the month before. You're always trying to do something better the month before. So, I don't know. I don't know where I got it from.
Especially I need to try it.
For the comedy, I don't know where I got it from. But I know it helped me tremendously over the years. Because it really fucking let me know if I was slipping. You know, it's your own little Bible. And at the end of the year, you just close it. And then you look at it 2 years later. And you go, Jesus Christ. Wow.
Do you just get high and, like, read through years of stand-up sometimes?
Sometimes it's painful. I was reading through Christmas of 2003 in Houston, Texas. And you could see where I was just a mess. I was writing sideways. I would write jokes on the paper. I remember those nights. Anyway. Like I said, man, this is what this podcast is about. Sometimes they're funny. Sometimes we torture Lee. Sometimes they torture me. Sometimes we say shit. And sometimes we just, you know, disclose things about your life that this is how you fucking do it, Lee. You keep a record of everything. I don't know why I started the comedy. It's really weird. Let's give a shout out to our sponsors and I'll get you motherfuckers out of here. You know, I do it now. I'm not going to lie to anybody. When I wake up in the mornings now, I sit and I relax with no music on, no sound, and I just let my mind go, and sometimes I get on the floor and I breathe, and sometimes I just sit there and just breathe and feel my internal. No matter how you look at it, it's a form of meditation. You know, let's be honest. Most of your problems start with your mind. Fear, anger, stress, anxiety, depression, sleeplessness, they begin in your head, but they can wreck your life. It doesn't have to be that way. You can make a major difference in just 10 minutes a day, all right? 10 minutes a day. This change comes through guided meditation with the new Headspace app. Joey, what are you talking about? Headspace is a meditation made simple, okay? It's guided meditations that you listen to whenever you want, wherever you want, right on your phone, computer, or tablet. Meditation is rooted in thousands of years of traditions, with thousands of scientific studies that show its positive effects, like improving focus, relationship harmony, and decreasing anxiety and stress. You know, for me, between 4 and 6 in the morning is when my head is at peace. I have to get up, breathe, calm it down, and that's when all the ideas flow in my head and whatever, and I just sit there. And again, it's just you and sound. That's it. Nothing else. Again, meditation is rooted in thousands of years of tradition. So do me a favor. Join over 4 million users already getting Headspace for free. For free, right now. Do me a favor. Download the free Headspace app and begin their Take 10 program for 10 days of guided meditation at headspace.com/Joey. The Headspace Take 10 program is a 100% free way to experience the benefits of meditation in your busy modern life. We're busy. We're busy. You click onto the Headspace app, Take 10 program, try it out for 10 days of guided meditation at headspace.com/Joey. Train your mind for a healthier, less stressed life. Start with your free trial today at headspace.com/Joey. Again, that's headspace.com/Joey. And also, do me one other favor. Please reference Andy Pettacombe's TED Talk, which is already 5.5 million views. All right, Andy is the founder of Headspace and the voice you hear on the app. You don't need to put, you know, loads of time in or emigrate to Tibet. Andy did that for you. This guy was a monk for 10 years. He really knows his stuff. 10 minutes is all I'm asking you to find, but it takes a little effort. It starts with you. So you're having problems. You're not focusing. Ba, 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 ba. Boom. Go to headspace.com/Joey. And get your free trial today. All right, try the app out. It's tremendous. I wouldn't even recommend it if I didn't think so. Since we're speaking about focus, excuse me, you want to be focused? Alpha Brain. That's it. Alpha Brain. You do a cycle Alpha Brain. excuse me. See what you're missing with Alpha Brain, okay? First off, 100% guaranteed. We don't even want the product back. If it doesn't work for you, if it doesn't do what we're telling you it does, you don't even have to send the product back. That's what Onnit does. It gives you the best of what they have. Whether it's the Shroom Tech, whether it's the Hemp Force Protein, whether it's the Testot. Listen, it all starts with you. Go to Onnit.com right now. Onnit is the web page. It's a supplement. Everybody's looking to get healthier. Everybody's looking for more focus, more energy. Onnit has the answer for you. But it starts with you. Go to Onnit.com right now. Look at the great list of supplements that they have for you. They have kettlebells and vests and coffee and all that stuff. I could only help you with the supplements. Go to Onnit.com right now and press in.
Church.
C-H-U-R-C-H. And get 10% off your first order. You're not going to be sorry. So again, go to headspace.com/Joey or Onnit.com/Church. Boom. And get 10% off, and it gets delivered right to your house. Again, I want to thank everybody who tapped in. Thank you for the great month of February. We'll be back Wednesday with a tremendous guest. We're going to surprise you motherfuckers. Again, all love to Cleo and all the people who have given the support from Water Boxer, Leon. You know who the fuck you are. You know we love you, cocksuckers. My man down in Austin with Crystal, my other Crystal that sent the basket, Bobby Sherman. Fucking Uki and my main man talking there, head of security. I love you, cocksucker. Stay black. I'll see you Wednesday. Have a great night.
This show is brought to you by Headspace. Go to headspace.com/Joey and download the free Headspace app and begin their Take 10 program. And this show is brought to you by Onnit. Go to onnit.com and use code word CHURCH to get 10% off all of the great optimization products.